Good morning. We actually begin with a prayer. So today, the church celebrates the feast day of Saint Claude de la Colombière, who was a 17th century French Jesuit priest, who was the spiritual director of Saint Margaret Mary Alacoque. Now, she was a French visitation nun and a mystic who began the devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. It's because of the both of them that we have the image of the Sacred Heart of Jesus in our central patio. As a matter of fact, the statue that we have in our central patio is an exact copy of the original that was sculpted according to the description of Saint Margaret Mary after her vision of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. So before we begin, I'm going to invite you to join me in a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Lord Jesus Christ, let our hearts never rest until they find you, you who are its center, its love, and its happiness. By the wound in your heart, pardon the sins that we have committed, whether out of malice or out of evil desires. Place our weak hearts in your own divine heart, continuously under your protection and guidance, so that we may persevere in doing the good and in fleeing evil until our last breath. We ask this in your holy name we pray. Amen. Our Lady of Belen, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So in 1526, at the age of 35, and 3 years removed from his conversion back to the Catholic faith, Ignatius of Loyola was a student of Latin and theology at the University of Paris. His college roommate was a young man from Navarra, Spain, by the name of Francisco de Jasso y Azpilicueta. Affectionately, they called him Francis Xavier. Now, Francis Xavier was a strong, attractive youth, a formidable college athlete who came from a prominent family and was focused on studying law in order to further his family's fortune. And day after day, night after night, Francis Xavier boasted about his great plans to finish college, marry a beautiful girl, and make a lot of money. He raved constantly about his athletic and romantic conquests. Ignatius of Loyola, on the other hand, was focused now on studying for the priesthood in order to preach the gospel wherever and whenever the church needed him. Now, he recognized in Francis Xavier extraordinary potential. He felt that such incredible enthusiasm and energy would be a great force for good in the world. But for as much as he spoke to Francis Xavier and encouraged him to pray, go to mass, go to confession, do the spiritual exercises, Francis Xavier didn't want anything to do with it. Then one day, they were walking together through the hallways of the university, and Ignatius turned to his roommate and said to him, "Francis, what profit is there for a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul in the process?" Now, these words of Jesus that are found in the Gospel of St. Mark change Francis Xavier's life forever. Most of us know the rest of the story. Francis Xavier changed his major, became a priest, helped Ignatius found the Society of Jesus, and then he went off to become the most prolific missionary in the history of the Catholic Church. Throughout India and Japan, literally hundreds of thousands of people were baptized at the hands of St. Francis Xavier. And this is kind of also the story of Belen. See, for nearly 170 years, the Jesuit priests and brothers of our school have been educating young men in the Catholic faith for only one purpose: the salvation of souls. There's no question that our formation is focused on being as successful as possible, but never at the expense of our Catholic values and principles. Ultimately, the salvation of our souls. This is what led eventually to our exile in 1961. when the draconian dictatorship of Fidel Castro forced the closure of Belen in Havana, the Jesuits understood the momentary inconvenience as simply that. It was momentary. Their zeal for souls brought them here to Miami, Florida, to reestablish our school in order to continue educating the ever-growing community of Cuban exiles who flooded South Florida in pursuit of a better life. From our very humble beginnings on the fourth floor of a dilapidated building in downtown Miami to the extraordinary campus that we find ourselves on today, Belen has desired only one thing: the formation of Catholic leaders. From entrepreneurs like Roberto Goizueta of the class of 1949, to trailblazing medical doctors like Eduardo Rodriguez of the class of 1984, Belen alumni are called to not simply excel in their profession of choice, but to excel in their service to others. It's the reason why our motto is Men for Others. Such is also the case with this morning's facilitator, Mr. Armando Codina, from the Belen class of 1965. Also, Mr. Codina is a victim of Castro's warped Marxist ideology that forced him out of his homeland and separated him from his family at a very young age. Mr. Codina made his way to the greatest nation in the world that offered him the opportunity to excel. Now, let me be absolutely clear. It wasn't a handout. It wasn't a crutch. It was an opportunity. An opportunity that, together with his Belen Jesuit education, he was able to take advantage of through hard work and perseverance in order to become one of the most successful entrepreneurs in South Florida. It's for this reason that last year, I asked Mr. Codina to be the commencement speaker at our graduation. See, this is the true measure of a successful man. It's not that his success lies in his extraordinary business endeavors or his great fortune, but that he always remained, first and foremost, faithful to his convictions and values as a Catholic man. So this brings me to this morning, right here in this theater. You, the young men of Belen Jesuit, are going to have an opportunity to listen to another great success. Mr. Ken Langone has not been asked to speak to you today because he's an American billionaire, or a businessman, or investor, author, and philanthropist, helping to finance the founders of the Home Depot. See, Mr. Langone has been asked to speak to you today because, first and foremost, he's a committed Catholic and has always remained faithful to his Christian values. See, he's living proof that you can have great success in the eyes of the world, but more importantly, have great success in the eyes of God. He understands the divine words of Jesus, the divine words quoted by St. Ignatius of Loyola that critical days in the hallways of the University of Paris. So, gentlemen of Belen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce this morning's facilitator, Belen alumnus and grandfather, my very good friend, Mr. Armando Codina.
I've been called a lot of things, but I've never been called a facilitator before. First time. I entertained you guys a little bit while Mr. Langone was in a hell of a traffic jam. Having entertained you already, let me be serious with you for a few minutes about what I was thinking when I was watching my two grandsons, all of you, the words of Father Willie, and it is, how blessed all of you, and I know you know that, are. How blessed is my daughter Andrea as a mother, and Margarita as a grandmother, that we have Belen, and that we have Father Willie. We are blessed that you are getting the kind of education that you are getting, where you are able to do a prayer in allegiance to the flag. I would have said that to you 5 years ago. But today, I would also say to you that in the world that we live in today, it is especially blessed, given what's going on the schools, what is being taught, the lack of allegiance to the flag, no prayers, and the kind of things they want to teach little kids without even parental input, let alone consent. Like Father Willie said, I was in Cuba, I was at Belen when Castro took over. So I have seen government intrusion, and we are very lucky. Many of you came from parents or grandparents who made the ultimate sacrifice so that you all would be free and that we're all in the greatest nation on the face of the earth. You're going to be further blessed by listening, meeting Ken Langone, because he's up here for a little bit, you're going to feel like you've known him for a long time. How many of you Google Ken Langone before the session today? Let me see. So I Google Ken Langone too, for the first time. Let me see. I need Phil. Okay. I Googled Mr. Langone too. First time, by the way, Ken, that I Googled you. So first thing that comes up is Ken Langone, Wikipedia. And when you go to Wikipedia, the first line says, an American billionaire businessman. Now, there's a lot of billionaires. And when I talk about American billionaires, the three people that came to my mind were these three. Elon Musk, Microsoft, Amazon, Tesla Plus, they're all certainly American businessmen. They are the ultimate billionaires, and they're remarkable, and their stories and what they've done is a tribute to this country. I'm particularly fond of Elon Musk and buying Twitter and doing what he's doing. So what they have many things in common, including the fact that unfortunately all three of them have a bit of a dysfunctional family. They're very public figures. So I would tell you that if you take all of their money combined and you gave it to me and I had to sacrifice my family, I wouldn't take it. So Google description is not adequate. Google is not the Bible. That's my description of Ken Langone. In Codinapedia. A man of faith, a great American and a patriot, a man of family, he should have husband before father. A good husband, good father. He's a good son, good brother, and I can tell you he's a great friend. He's generous, he's loyal, he is ethical to a fault, but most of us, he's a good man. So I'm going to concentrate for a second on the generous for 1 minute. So that's Ken and his wife, Elaine Langone. As you can see by looking at Elaine, he's a good salesman. You see how good she looks. So 2008, Langone made a large contribution to NYU, and it became the NYU Medical Center later, NYU Langone, 2008. In 2018, 10 years later, You know, one thing is to write a check, and another thing is to write a check and get involved. And that's what he does. So in 2018, they stood, Elaine and Ken, it stood to announce that the medical school would be tuition-free to everyone who attended. Thanks to Ken Langone. When Cardinal Nolan needed help to restore St. Patrick's Cathedral, who do you think he called? Ken Langone. Ken Langone raised the money. He gave a lot of money and raised the money. Ken won't remember this, but there was I was in New York visiting with him, and I said, hey, Kenny, how do you raise all this money from Protestants and Jews and, you know, people that... And the Jewish community is very giving. So what he said to me, quote unquote, was, oh, it's easy. I went to see them in their office, grabbed them by the ankle, turned them upside down, and shook them until the last penny came out. The last nickel, he said. So that is not why. You know the reason why he raised all the money? Because he leads by example. So before and after of St. Patrick. So it was Ken Langone, the papal visit. The Pope came to the opening of St. Patrick Cathedral, and it was Ken Langone and Elaine who welcomed him. He wrote a book. I showed you before he came in. American. I love capitalism. I want to read you two paragraphs from the book that tells you everything you need to know about Mr. Langone, because it's not about billionaires, it's about values. So the very first page of this book, the very first page, you see it there. You will see it here. The very first page. So, to my wife and sons, with my everlasting love and gratitude. And when you turn that page, this is the first thing you see. I'm going to let you read it rather than reading out to you, since I'm about to lose my voice. So read that. That's what Mr. Langone is about. He's a good man. He's a good friend. He's a force of nature. So I want you to give Ken Langone, bring him up with a Belen applause for the interview. Ken, we got a lot of questions, but before I ask you the first question, why don't you say hello?
What's that?
Say hello.
Hello, guys and gals. And keep that enthusiasm up, even when I'm as late as I was. Thank you.
So, Kenny, I want to start. The kids, these are not kids, these young men send a lot of questions, and I had to process it and think about it. So I want you to take, I want to go step by step. So tell them about your early life. I know about lots of love and not a lot of money. So take us through your family life. Take me to college, okay. Up to college.
I was raised in a very faithful environment. My mom and dad had virtually no education. My mother went to the 7th grade. My father went to the 8th grade. My father was a plumber. My mother worked in a school cafeteria. And you heard the expression today, they lived from paycheck to paycheck. They lived from paycheck to paycheck. But because there was so much love in that house from not only my parents, but my grandparents and my aunts and my uncles, and my brother, my late brother, I never felt poor. We always had a warm house with no air conditioning. We always had plenty of food. But that was about the extent of the material aspects of life. But what I had was, and which was the most important thing they gave me, was this faith in the Lord that if I wanted to be something bad enough and I was willing to go through all the effort and sacrifice, I might not reach my goal, but God would always be with me. And my grandmother, God bless her soul, rest in peace, both of them, my grandparents, neither one of them could speak English. However, my grandfather insisted that his grandchildren speak nothing but English because he said, I came to this country because where I was, there was no future for me and my family. And they invoked in me this great sense of obligation and passion for my faith and my family and my country. And that was my upbringing. I was an altar boy. I was mischievous. I shouldn't say this because some of the leaders here might get upset. But I was asked to resign from being an altar boy because another altar boy and I got caught drinking the wine. And that was a no-no. So we could be mischievous. And Father Ryan, who was the pastor, said, I'm not going to tell them why I'm firing you guys. I'm going to simply tell them you're both taller than I am, and that means you're too old to be an altar boy. And that's what he did. But I never forgot that lesson. I never forgot the love and affection that I always felt. I knew no matter what, my parents would endow in me from them unconditional love, that no matter what I became, no matter what I was, they would always be there for me. And that's, to me, the most precious thing a parent can give a child. I watch Armando and Maggie with their family, and I'm mindful of the fact, for example, my first call every morning is at 6 o'clock in the morning to my son in New York, Bruce, and my other sons, one's Arizona, one's in New York. We talk on the phone all the time. And the last thing we say to each other on each call, I love you. And we mean it. But I can't stress enough, the glue that holds all of it together is my faith. My faith in the Lord. For what it's worth, if you want some idea, they keep calling me a billionaire, so I guess I'm a billionaire. I don't feel like a billionaire, but so be it. My day starts, I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I go and brush my teeth. Comb with a little bit of hair I have. I still have my pajamas on. I go into the kitchen, and then we have an automatic coffee pot, and I fill up a carafe, and I bring it. My wife sleeps till 6 o'clock, so I don't wake her up. And then I go back in to the kitchen and get myself a cup of coffee, and I go in, and I sit down in the library. And the very first thing I do is, there's a book I read called Jesus Calling. It's a reading every day. And it's about how much the Lord is in our lives and how important it is that we recognize that we should turn over to Him all the things in life that are a stress. In fact, coming down here, by the way, I can tell you one thing. New York can handle the traffic jam a lot better than Miami. But coming down here, as I'm anxious about being late because I really wanted to be here with you kids, I was saying the rosary, and it worked. I didn't yell at anybody. I didn't get mad. It worked. God was there with me. So the first thing I do is I read Jesus Calling. Then there's a little book I have called The Upper Room that has a biblical reading in it, and it relates to your life on a daily basis. Then I say the rosary. I want to get done saying the rosary. People may have remembered, I know Armando knew him very well, Frank Borman. Frank Borman was the astronaut. It was the first time to go around the moon, saw the other side of the moon, him and two other astronauts. And he and I became very good friends. And about 50 years ago, he and I were talking one night, and I said, Frank, you put your butt in this thimble, this little thing. You can't believe how small it is that held three men. And you fire yourselves off. And what happens, Frank, if instead of turning around and coming back, it keeps going straight? weren't you worried? He said, no, I wasn't worried. I said, why weren't you worried? He said, well, I had these prayers with me that I said. And I said, could I have a copy of those prayers? So the last thing I do is I read Frank's prayers from space about him, about God in our life and the importance of doing the right thing, and St. Francis's prayer, all the Beatitudes, all the things that we should understand matter in life. Then I get up and then I go to the gym, and then when I get back, there's a wonderful retreat house up on US 1 in North Palm Beach, and they have an 8 o'clock mass. There's four priests there. I prefer three of the four because the fourth guy likes homilies a little longer than I do, but I go to mass every morning. And I can only tell you one thing. The importance of Jesus Christ in my life can't be stressed enough. I know this much, that this country's going through a very difficult phase right now. And some of the things that are happening in America break our heart. But I have absolutely no doubt that the good Lord will see us through it better and stronger. And that's what you want to believe in. You want to believe tomorrow is going to be better than today. And the next day is going to be better than tomorrow, and so forth. You got to have faith, and you got to believe in yourself and your family. You got to believe in your values, and you got to live your values. That's the essence of what I did in my life. Sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. I make mistakes. I commit sins. I do all the things that a human being does. But at the end of the day, that faith restores to me the foundation that makes me feel like tomorrow is going to be better than today.
Danny, talk about your college. Tell them where you went to college. What did you study?
I was not going to go to college. It was 1953. I wanted to go in the Marine Corps. My brother was in the 82nd Airborne Division in the Army. And I wanted to go in the Marines. But I was only 17, and my mother, mom, dad, we only had two children, my brother and me. My mother wouldn't sign me in because she said, God forbid, she had one son at risk. And if she signed the other one, and they both were at risk, she'd never forgive herself. So I had to wait until September. Well, but in the meantime, a couple of friends of mine invited me to a little college in Pennsylvania called Bucknell University. And I went up, and I spent the weekend, and I said, my God, if this is what college is all about, this is fabulous. Long story short, by accident, I met the dean of admissions, and he interviewed me, and I told him I was going in the Marine Corps. And lo and behold, they sent me an invitation to come to Bucknell, even though I'd never applied. And that's a very important part of my life. So I went and I studied. I studied economics and political science. In my freshman year, at the end of my freshman year, I had the wonderful good fortune of the gift of the Lord to meet my wife. And this coming September, we'll be married 67 years. And I can tell you right now, I'm more nuts about her now than I was the first time I set sight on her. That was another gift of the Lord, that he brought Elaine into my life. And so I went to Bucknell, came to New York, got a job with an insurance company, went to school at night to get my MBA at NYU, got called into the Army, around when they built the wall around Belen, got out of the Army, went to Wall Street, started for $150 a week, and as they say, the rest is history. But it only happened faith, family, country. That's why it happened. Not me. Yeah, I was pretty able, but only with a strong faith and values, and only with a family that is always going to be there for you. And finally, in a nation that gives you a chance to be whatever you want to be. And when I put that flag on every morning, I look up at the ceiling and I say to my grandparents, who are both dead now, thank you for coming to America. Armando and I talk all the time about the greatness of America, what he did, what I did, all the good things we can do with our life. It wouldn't happen except in this great country. And don't ever forget that.
Kenny, talk about the transition from a job to when you founded your firm.
Okay. I started out at $150 a week, and I was a pretty good salesman. I was a very good salesman. And I did very, very well, and they made me a partner. And then the firm wanted to convert into a bond house from stocks and bonds, which was fine with me, but I wanted to be involved in business. I wanted to help people who created businesses. I wanted to help people create jobs. I wanted to take my finance knowledge and apply it in a setting. And again, here's the good Lord. The good Lord had the good fortune of having Bernie Marcus get fired. I knew him. And when he got fired, it freed him up, because he would have stayed there forever. And I persuaded him, let's start a company. And of course, the company's Home Depot. And let me tell you the greatest part of Home Depot. We have today 3,000, I call them kids. Anybody who's under 87, Armando's a kid because he's under 87. I'm 87. Anybody who's under 87 is a kid. We have 3,000 kids that started for working for Home Depot in the parking lot, pushing carts in and helping customers load their cars up. 3,000. They didn't go to college. I'm not suggesting you shouldn't go to college. I'm just pointing out to you what you can be if you want to be bad enough. 3,000 that are multimillionaires and still working for the company.
Kenny, what year was Home Depot founded? What was the minimal? You raised all the money.
Okay.
How much did you raise and what was the minimal amount?
We started the company with $2 million. The minimum amount was $25,000, and the most that anybody invested was $100,000. I put up $100,000. We had 40 investors. Bernie and Arthur, Arthur Blank owns the Atlanta Falcons now, and of course Bernie is incredibly philanthropic. Every place you look, he's given money in huge amounts. Myself and Pat Farah. Pat had just declared bankruptcy. Now think about that. This is what you can be if you want to be it bad enough. Two guys who were fired, one guy who just took bankruptcy, and another guy in New York City that had struggled to raise $2 million to start the company.
Kenny, how much, if I had invested the minimum, $25,000?
You'd have 300.
When you found it, how much is that 25 worth?
If you had put $25,000 in and never sold a share, you'd have $300 million in stock today.
Do you hear that?
Okay, you'd have, let me give you $300 million by, let's say, 300 is a million. Your dividends would be $7.5 million a year. Okay? Dream big, work hard, have passion for what you're doing. That's it.
Kenny, look what I had them put up there. You want to talk about that a little bit?
Yes, by all means. There's the pyramid. When we started the company, most companies are hierarchical. The top guy is here, and the newest kid hired is at the bottom, at the base, triangle. We flipped it. We said the most important people in the company are the people on the floor in the store. Why? Because they're the ones that touch the customers every single day. And business is very simple. No customers, no business. Lots of customers, lots of business. Lots and lots of customers, a very successful business. So we started with a belief that the top guys are at the bottom of the pyramid, and the bottom guys see frontline associates. Top guy is the customer, then you got to feel, and then you go right down the line. Because really, that kid that I talked about pushing carts in, the last person that the customer sees before they drive away is that kid that helped them fill their car up. And depending on the attitude of that kid, that's the impression that the customer is going to have of us as a company. Thank you, man. I'm very impressed. There's a wonderful company down here in Florida called Publix. I am very, very impressed with the training they do of their people and the attitude their people have. And on a personal level, one of the things I'm most proud of at Home Depot, we have a program called Ken's Crew.
I was going to ask you about that.
Okay. Ken's Crew started out as Ken's Kids. But they've grown up, so they're not kids anymore, so we can't call them Ken's kids anymore, although I would call them a kid, because they're less than 87. But that was changed to be called Ken's crew. These are people who are challenged, Down syndrome, autism, all different forms of human condition that presumably limits their ability. These people are hired by the company. They are not given menial jobs. They don't do janitorial work. They have the same exact responsibilities as every other person in that store. They interface with the customers. Where they have the ability to help the customers, they do. Whatever they're capable of doing is what they do. But the most important part of that program is the impact that it has on all the other people in the store. The sense of pride and accomplishment. Think of yourself, you're in a store, you're working next to a kid that's challenged. He's Down syndrome or whatever. In a wheelchair, cerebral palsy. And you're helping that kid. Well, guess what? He's helping you as much as you're helping him. Because he's making you learn the importance and value of compassion, of caring, of giving. The smile you can bring on somebody else's face by your work makes you feel so good about yourself. And that's very important. Because you can't respect anybody else if you don't respect yourself. Don't forget that. If you don't have a good feeling about yourself, and God made you very special, there's no two people on this earth. There's 7.5 billion people, believe it or not. There's no two people exactly. Each one of you were made separate in your own image and likeness of God. And that's important. So how, getting back to those kids and helping those kids, you're helping yourself. Because when you leave at night, you go home, you say, I had a pretty good day today. I made life a little better for Johnny, or I helped John. I can go on and on and on. Don't miss those opportunities to help yourself by helping others.
Kenny, I was recruited to the Board of Home Depot by Kenny.
He didn't have a chance.
My wife, we were in Connecticut. I have served on a number of boards. I didn't want to serve on any more boards. And Maggie said, who's coming for lunch? I said, Ken Langone. Who's Ken Langone? I told him who Ken Langone was, founder of Home Depot. What is he coming for? I think he wants me to be on the board. You're not going to do that, are you? I said, no, I'm not going to do that. He said, but I got to listen. You know, he's Ken Langone. So he was supposed to be there for half an hour. So 2 hours later, I walk in. Maggie said to me, did you tell him no? I said, no, you tell him no. So he was Ken that recruited me to the Board of Home Depot, and the culture hasn't changed. Kenny, how many million? What company has made more millionaires than any?
Nobody. We're the best. I want to say one thing about why I had to have him. I really didn't have that feeling until I got a ride from where the helicopter brought me. What was the man's name? Al. Mm-hmm. The guy,
my guy Eddie.
Eddie picked me up. I love to talk to drivers, to waiters. You learn so much from these people about people, other people. And so I said, Eddie and I were talking in the car, and I asked him a little bit about himself and his family. Eddie has a challenged son. And when Eddie told me all about the Codina family and how kind they were to take care of his family, and here's this young lad, they bring him up to the country in Connecticut in the summer, and Eddie's talking about what changes in his life happened because of the Codinas. Before I ever met him, I said, I'm getting this guy. Because this is what you want in people. People who are blessed beyond their wildest dreams, but who have a great sense of reaching out and helping. So Armando, Eddie was my recruiter, I can tell you that right now.
So, God forbid. So when Kenny recruited me, I became chairman of governance and nominating.
Right.
And as chairman of nominating, I will tell you, that to recruit directors to Home Depot, you have to recruit people who are very humble. There are a lot of very accomplished people that would not. So chemistry in the board, you would agree, Kenny?
Yes.
It's very, very important. And that culture still prevails in Home Depot. I'm going to take a second here because I lost complete track of time. Father Willie, how much time do we have?
Okay.
15 minutes?
I apologize again, kid.
No. The Kenny. So, Kenny, I admire many things about you, by the way. Like you and I, when we walk into a restaurant, we relate better to the boss boy and the waiters than we do to.
Right.
It's an important part of that. But the other thing Kenny Langone has is that he's got a lot of street smarts. You know, you can be very smart, by the way. You can be educated. Having a gut, having sense. So he has a very big BS meter detector. So if you got a lot of BS. So how many of you have heard of Bernie Madoff? Raise your hand. It's the biggest Ponzi schemer. So Kenny was one guy he could... He tried to get some money out of Kenny when he was desperate. So Kenny, would you tell the story about your encounter with Bernie Madoff?
I was asked to meet with him. I had just sold one of my companies. It was 2008 when the world, quote, was coming to an end financially. And we had just sold our company for a lot of money. So it was pretty well known. I had some cash. It was not Home Depot that was sold, it was another company. And the fellow said, Bernie Madoff would like to meet you, and I'd like you to meet with him. And a good friend of mine, I said, sure, I'll be happy to meet with him. So I met with him, and all he wanted to do was show me his art. Now, I'm not sophisticated enough to know great art from good art, from bad art, but I suffered the guy and walked around. I thought, well, Bernie, we've been at it an hour. Let's talk about what you want to talk about. I brought my partner, Steve Holzman, who lives here in Miami. I brought him in to meet with Bernie and me because this guy knew more about the stuff Bernie was doing. And this is where the Bible comes into play. And by the way, remember this. If you go to college or you go to business school, and they say you can only have one book to learn, read the Bible. Forget everything else. Just read the Bible. He was going to give me a deal, and I'd never done business with him, that he wasn't going to give to any of his other clients. And my first thought was, if I was one of those other clients, how would I feel that he gave this great deal? He told me it was such a great deal. He gave this great deal to me, who'd never done business with him, and these other people who'd been with him for 25 and 30 years weren't going to get any of it. So I thanked him. I listened. Steve and I got down in the lobby of the building, and I said, Steve, I brought you. He was living in Sun Valley for the summer. I made him come into New York. I said, Steve, I feel bad. I don't want to do it. He said, why do you want to do it? I said, well, Steve, there's a wonderful saying in the Bible, do unto others as you have others do unto you. I said, I can't do this, because if I was an investor and I didn't get a chance to see this deal, I wouldn't be very happy. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be a part of a transaction where people have a right to feel that they were screwed. He said, well, let me think about it. He called a week later. Boom, 2 weeks later, Bernie Madoff is taken out in handcuffs. The number of lives he destroyed.
How many? What was the magnitude of the...
It was about $15 or $16 billion.
$15 or $60 billion over many years. This guy keep racing.
Right.
And you know what? Kenny, as I told you, has a big BS meter detector. But part of the problem with other people is greed.
Right.
So he was offering these outside returns. So guys, if it looks too good to be true,
it isn't true.
Generally, it ain't true. So you gotta be, so you gotta know that there was a movie, you can watch it, called The Wizard of Lies. The history of Bernie Madoff and there's a guy, Langone is on the movie, not him, but a guy by the name of Ray Iannelli.
He was a midget, he's about that high.
So Kenny, how did that happen? The guy is...
Because Robert De Niro didn't want somebody taller than him in the scene. And because I was used to be 6'3", I'm about 6'2 now. And they had this little short, bald-headed guy playing me.
Kenny, he was short, ugly, and bald. I understand bald, but short and ugly, you should have sued De Niro on there.
Wow.
And the movie guys.
You know, there's one thing I want to leave you all with, apropos what we're talking about now. Do two things in life. Be yourself. Whatever you are, that's the way God made you. Be yourself, and be true to your values.
Kenny, I want to talk about, because we have a limited time.
Go ahead.
I want to talk about the next subject. If you guys don't listen to anything else, listen to this. Because you guys have been strapped with an amount of debt, and most young people are oblivious. Let's talk a little bit about the debt in this country and talk a little bit about that.
The debt in this country is, to me, the worst enemy we have. Not China, not Russia, not Iran, not anything. The biggest single threat we have to us as a nation is this profligate spending with no accountability. I feel terrible, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, I feel terrible about my grandchildren and you, all of you, being left with this humongous debt, including, don't forget, all these entitlements we have in America that have to be paid for. So how do I feel about the debt? I know how you feel, and I share that feeling. I'm terrified of it. I worry about it. Remember this. Anytime you expect the government to do everything for you, the government has a right to assume they own you. We don't want, that's totalitarianism. We don't want that in America. So I'm pleading with you kids, I'm begging you, for your future, not mine. Be mindful of what this debt can do to this nation. And I'll leave you with another thought. We've had dictators come and go on Earth. Stalin, Hitler, Mussolini, Castro, go right down the list. 2,000 years, we still have Jesus Christ. Napoleon, all the rest of them are gone. They're gone. So have your faith, but back to Armando about the debt. I plead with you, take on responsibility. In your own life, be accountable for yourself and your family. And by the way, Armando, I didn't plan to pitch this. I'm right in the middle of finishing a book now called The Psychology of Money. It's a very small book, and I urge you kids to read it, because it's going to be a great roadmap for your life. But this debt can paralyze this country, and it will. It has to end. It has to stop. We have to, at some point, live within our means. Every family that's attached to each one of you here lives within its means. We're not doing that, Armando. Right. And as a nation, we're being encouraged to think it's limitless. It's not limitless. One day, the Grim Reaper will show up. And when he does or she does, it's not going to be pretty. So I plead with you, be conscious of that.
Another way, by the way, to look at it, to take it to a different level, is if you think about the interest on the debt that this country will owe, will soon overcome how much we spend in defense. and look at the world that we're living in. So the biggest worry that I have in my life is, you know, I've always tried to leave things better than I found them. And I think that's the hope and aspiration of every parent generational in America. I worry for my grandkids when I look at what's happening in the country with the dead, even morally. So you guys should pay attention. You should be educated about this. Want to give you another number, by the way, that I failed to tell you. Mr. Langone has given over $200 million to NYU Medical, NYU Health now, over $200 million. So that gives you an idea. So, Father Willie doesn't know. I mentioned it to you all while we were making a little bit of time. So, Father Willie, this is completely optional. So anyone that's here today that would write you a note, a brief note telling you, describing the takeaway that they got from this Langone exchange, and why they want to read this book, we will send you a book with, I'm going to get a photograph of Ken and I up here. We're going to dedicate it. So any of you who want to read the book, this is the book that should be taught in the public school system, not the kind of crap they're pushing on the kids today. I love capitalism.
If you will, how many kids are here? 400? How many kids are here? Okay, if you will, give me their first names. I'll inscribe a book to each one of them about, when you read my inscription, you'll understand why.
I'm going to leave you with this. We're going to close with this. And I told you this before, but I want to tell you in front of Mr. Langone. I told you billionaires are, thank God, in this country, a dime a dozen. I have met many billionaires. The only happy, fulfilled billionaire that I've met is Ken Langone, because of his faith, because of who he is. So let's give a Belen round of applause for Ken Langone.
I love you.
Thank you. Let's get this picture here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Come forward. Come on in the picture.
So one last thing.
Yes. I want
to tell you this was going to be special.
It is special.
Before Mr. Langone leaves, I want to take the opportunity to thank Mr. Langone for coming all the way down here to speak with you, and just reemphasize something. And here's the thing: we launched our entrepreneurship program last year, and one of the things that we wanted to do is we wanted to design specifically a Catholic entrepreneurship group. What's the intention? And this is not only for entrepreneurship and business, it's just everything. You can be highly successful, while still remaining very faithful to your values as Catholic men. They are not one thing opposed to the other. On the contrary, of all the things you said today, Mr. Langone, I got to tell you, the one thing that really impressed me was, especially from your level of expertise, that the one book that you definitely need to take with you, if there's no other, would be the Bible. Everything that is told to us by Jesus Christ affects every single aspect of our lives. Yeah. Not just on Sundays when we go to Mass, not only when Father Willie has you to go to Mass here at Belen, it's every aspect of who we are. And I wanted to thank Mr. Langone for that. And of course, thank our very good friend and my very good friend, Mr. Armando Codina, for bringing Mr. Langone here to us and also facilitating the experience.
I want to say one more thing. I just thought of something. When I got dressed this morning, I picked this tie out specifically. If you look closely at it, it's a flying pig. Why did I bring this tie? Because when I took the job at NYU to be head of the hospitals, and I told them our aspiration was one day to be number one, some wise guy at another hospital in New York said, pigs will fly before that hospital is number one. The pigs are flying, and by the way, we are now the number one hospital in America.
I told you. I told you guys. He was worth their weight.
So, Mr. Langone, before you go.
Yes, sir.
Before you go, one last gift. We'd like to give you something, and I know we have something in the wings for you personally, but something that the young men can give you. I'm going to ask them to please stand. So we have a very...
Wow.
We have a...
Wow.
We have a very... Mr. Langone, we have a very strong devotion
to... Call me Ken, please.
Ken, we have a very strong devotion in this school to our Blessed Mother, and she's... Our Lady of Belen has protected us for 168 years God since our founding in 1854. We have a song, which is our alma mater, which is a prayer to our Blessed Mother, and we would like, as members of the upper class of Belen, we'd like to sing it for you and offer it, more than importantly, as a prayer for you and for your work. So, gentlemen, together. Salve Regina, Mater Misericordiae, Vita Dulcedo, Espes Nostra Salve. A te clamamus, exules filii Eve, a te suspiramus, gementes et flentes, in ac lacrimarum vae. Eia ergo, avocata nostra, illos tuos misericordes oculos a nos converte. Et Jesum, benedictum fructus ventris tuis, nobis post hoc exilium ostende. O clemens, O pia, O dulcis Virgo Maria. Our Lady of Belen, thank you, sir, very much.
God bless you all. Thank you, my mother. Thank you for letting me.